This is the panel I've been looking for. It will contend with the question, are these two theaters or one? Jillian, over to you.
Thank you so much. I'm happy to be moderating this panel. I think what we're dealing with is a really complex global threat environment. You have obviously the crisis in Ukraine, but we're looking at a world where you have a China that wants to expand its influence and become a competing superpower to the United States. And you've got an Iran that's being more active too, causing instability in the region and instability in Europe. So with that, I'm actually going to kick it off to you, Andrew, first. Since we're talking about this really complex threat environment, it seems like a weird moment from the U.S. perspective, having been the predominant superpower. How do you read this moment and the challenges that we face?
Okay, well, first of all, thank you to the organizers for inviting me. Second, since I work for the Defense Department, I'm speaking in my private capacity as an analyst and not necessarily expressing the views of the DOD or the Marshall Center. To your question, Jillian, this is a long overdue wake-up call in terms of the world we live in. We've been in a strategic slumber, I would argue, when it comes to the actual power distribution over the last 20 years, in large part because of the pain following the 9/11 attacks that kind of hit at some of the most cherished elements of American security. We were attacked at home. We live in a world where we believe we're entitled to a very broad margin of security, right? A lot of threatening Canadians to the right, to the north, Mexicans to the south, so a lot of water left and right. And so that created a kind of spasm of reaction that took us into 20 years of overseas contingencies and so-called global war on terror. We were beginning to wake up, I would argue, already at the beginning of the Trump administration. If you look at the national security strategy and national defense strategy, it for the first time downgrades the importance of counterterrorism and looks at China and Russia as the principal adversaries. If you look now at the Biden administration strategic documents, you have this reiterated with some more specificity where we look at Russia as essentially an urgent threat, a revisionist power. I would argue Russia is trying to relitigate 1991. This is almost like the last battle of the end of the Cold War, maybe second to the last. We don't know what's going to follow up. But China is seen as a pacing challenge and a pacing threat. In other words, China is seen as an existential threat to the United States and to all democracies. While Russia wants to revise the post-Cold War settlement, return back to Europe as a political power, reassert itself in Eurasia, China wants to, in effect, replace the order that we've put in place and build one around its values, its institutions, its concept of kind of mercantile capitalist economy, and also its values in terms of the relationship between the individual and the state. So just to conclude, we look at these two theaters as interconnected. And although we have a debate which one should take priority, there's a cohort of analysts who argue that we should actually refocus on Asia and de-emphasize Europe. But that debate is driven largely by resource constraints. It's how big the force is, how you know, supplied it is. It's not a strategic debate to me in that sense.
Great. Well, actually, on that note, I want to kick it over to Professor Yoshizaki, because I think you're completely right on the resource point. And one thing that Asia is thinking a lot about is deterrence. We've seen the disruptive effect of the war in Ukraine, not just on regional stability and Europe's stability, but on the global supply chain. So when we're talking about deterrence, how the West is looking at deterrence, how China's neighbors are looking at deterrence, can you talk a little bit about that? And I'm not only talking about from a military perspective. I know we have people here from CSIS that just came out with a phenomenal report about China's economic coercion, how it's bullying neighbors and trying to get them to align with their foreign policy goals. So can you talk a little bit about deterrence, both in a military sense with Taiwan and on an economic sense?
Thank you very much for this opportunity. And let me start with the way we are. Hiroshima, G7 summit just begun. This is a big day for Japan. And also, the name of Hiroshima has a very specific message to the global one, that is a nuclear element. And don't forget that Mr. Putin made a reference to the nuclear things back in February. and the disarmament thing and strategic arms control. And he wanted French nuclear forces, British nuclear forces to be counted and reduced. That means he cared a lot about the European nuclear theater forces. Now, two leaders of these nuclear weapon states of Europe is now in Hiroshima, and also agreed on denuclearizations, and also a possibility for extended deterrence. That is the quite visible value for extended deterrence, not only for, okay, Hiroshima, Tokyo, Japan, Okinawa, Taiwan issue as well, but also European theater. That is the global connectivity. In that sense, commitment of interdependence or interdependence commitment matters, not only in Ukraine, but also Taiwan and beyond. Maybe the connecting the two theater by chance or by urgency. But now it is time to think about the like-minded partnership that you mentioned about the economic coercion. In that sense, how to reduce the dependence on the critical capability or critical data on China or some others may be a common challenge. In that sense, not only extended deterrence as an agenda, but also extended partnership, plus resilience support the Ukraine and some other regional counterparts may be common concern for all of us in this room. Thank you.
Great. Well, General Thani, I want to kick it off to you at this point, because we are living in a new era of great power competition that I think perhaps some of us thought was over with the collapse of the Berlin Wall. So what is it like for countries that are trapped in the middle of that? What calculations are they making about what the world looks like, and with economic decisions, with security decisions, which way to lean?
Well, first of all, thank you for the organizers for having me, and I'll share my neighbor to my left's comment that I also do not represent my government's position, but as an independent research fellow. Now, it's important to understand that with great power competition, that concept is quite new. I mean, it's relatively new. It emanated from the United States as part of a strategic view of where the United States sees itself among the great powers, China and Russia. Now, when it comes to the Middle East, we see that that competition is quite heightened. It was for Russia until recently even more active, obviously, because of the sanctions. Russia is no longer as active in the Middle East, at least not from an economic perspective. There were attempts and ideas of exploring in the hydrocarbon field, but obviously because of sanctions, that didn't happen. But we see, obviously, China is a big partner of many countries in the MENA, the Middle East and North African region. And for many nations in the Middle East and North African region, China is a very vital and important partner. But it's also, we need to understand that it goes both ways. China relies on 40% of its hydrocarbon energy from the Middle East. That for China is a vulnerability. And to secure itself from any effects of that vulnerability, it will need to advance its influence in the region in ways beyond trade. And we've seen recently, obviously, with the Chinese mediation between the rapprochement of Iran and Saudi Arabia, that they've now expanded in new fields that they were not active in beyond economy. So those things are quite important for those of us who are monitoring the region between Europe and the Indo-Pacific, and obviously the effects that occur from the other side, which is the United States, vis-a-vis the great power competition doctrine or approach.
Well, I think you raise a fantastic point on that. And Eva, I want to ask you about, we're looking at this great power competition. It's easy for me as an American to look at it from an American perspective. But since we do have these two theaters, how should we look at this from a global perspective?
Thanks, Jillian. It's a pleasure to be here as well, of course. I personally find this whole one versus two theater discussion fascinating, not the least because it always boils down to Europe needing to do more, and who could disagree with that? But before we even get there, I think there are a couple of very important points that we need to bear in mind. And one has to do with the fundamental difference between the two theaters. And it's not just about one being land-based and the other maritime, or the type of vulnerabilities that they house, etc. But it's about the nature and the way of operating of the two challengers. Yesterday, we heard General Andrzejczak, I think, saying that war was Russia's traditional instrument of doing politics. Now, frankly, you can't say the same thing about China. Instead, China very much prefers to win without fighting, to quote Sun Tzu again. And that doesn't mean that it's less dangerous, but as some, and as Andrew said about the pacing challenge, some compare Russia to being a storm or superstorm, and China being a climate change. And I quite like this comparison because it really kind of proceeds through these incremental little changes that are barely visible at first, but really pose a greater challenge afterwards. So we are really operating in this kind of vast range of threats, trade, technology, research, lawfare, which is a comfort zone for China, all this plethora of gray zone operations. And it brings me to my second point, if I can, that is Taiwan. All this discussion, at least since Ukraine started, was a lot about Taiwan. And Taiwan is not the only security challenge in East Asia. Let's make sure. And this two-front predicament is based on the assumption that the US will need to face two conflicts simultaneously at the same time. Now, a year and a half into the conflict, China did not invade Taiwan. I mean, it did not use this window of opportunity to do so. And it makes us think about something that I'm aware is hugely unpopular to say, and it's a daring idea, that maybe China does not want to invade militarily Taiwan. And I think it's important to raise this. Simply because of a fact.
Actually, can we get to that in a second? Because what you're saying, I think, really aligns with something that Andrew has been talking about. So we've got this threat environment, and we're very concerned about what's happening in Ukraine. We're also concerned about the viability of defending Taiwan. So I want to talk about that before we talk about some of the economic coercion and takeover by different means. But Andrew, as we're looking at this threat environment, yesterday we heard from the generals how dire the ammunition shortage is, how difficult it is to ramp up weapons production. And I wanted to ask you a little bit about how bad is it if we do have two physical crises, if we have warfare breakout in the Asia-Pacific region at the same time that it's happening in Europe, how well equipped is the West to cope with that? And if we're not well-equipped, what do we need to be doing?
The situation is really bad, and we're not where we need to be. We're coming off 30 years of essentially the just-in-time culture, the efficiency culture. We've reduced our defense industrial base significantly. We don't have redundancies in the system. For 20 years, we operated on the basis of secure logistics. So, you know, U.S. deployments to the Middle East or to Afghanistan or elsewhere. Only sporadically, you know, Iran, we're under threat. But by and large, we are operating in a very benign environment. All of this has changed. So we need to rethink how we produce munitions, how we produce equipment. We need to accept that our logistics will be under threat in a possible future conflict with China or with Russia. And we also need to, in effect, realize that there are no shortcuts. I mean, we need to build, not just, we need to rethink not just how we do defense production, but we need to rethink how we do our economies, so to speak. Because defense industry is not a separate, you know, cocoon, separate area. It's part and parcel of our economic structures. The U.S. shed about 35% of its manufacturing capacity over the last 40 years. So that, and Europe is in a similar area when it comes to defense production. Defense industry is not in the charity business. You know, they will not build stocks if they don't have contracts. So that's on the governments.
Got it. Well, with that, Professor, I wanted to ask you, so I think Eve is raising the point that China accomplishes things not just by physical force, but by coercion. And I wanted to ask you how well you think that the West has responded to that threat. I'm looking at the study that just came out, looking at 8 different cases, and many of them in the Asia-Pacific region. So do you feel like we have a strategy to deal with that? Is that, I know it's going to be a huge focus of the G7, but I wondered, just as a neighbor, as somebody in the region, how vulnerable do you feel? And also with the United States, I mean, we've got on one hand what happened in Afghanistan, which I think really undermined confidence in American commitments. On the other hand, you have Ukraine, where there has been strong American commitment. So as an ally, how confident do you feel that the West is going to back you up?
Thank you. Well, let me talk about the 3 things about the management. On the top, alliance management was a long-term challenge since the 1970s or 80s, and it's a long-term, big, big challenge, how to ensure the extended deterrence, how to let Washington, D.C. care more about our region, so-called the Far East. But the second level is crisis management, like Taiwan contingency issues or gray zone situation. Now we have to think about the 3rd dimension, that is the national level. And the most critical one is the time management. We have to think about the time frame. And 2027, the year 2027 became a kind of focal year or year of maximum danger or uncertainties. That means the time is not on our favor and maybe enemy, how we can fix it. Now Japan has a so-called 5-year defense procurement plan, and it used to be the financial element was a driving force. Now it's changed. That means security concerns and the effectiveness or readiness will be the driving force. That means thinking about the unthinkable. That's the lesson learned from the Ukraine. Okay, gray zone situation was a kind of buzzword for many years. Now we tend to get over, we are going to get over the not only a gray zone, but think about the war situations or kind of contingency. I think that is a big, big challenge for Japanese strategic culture, but I think we have a lot of possibility to do that.
General, I'm going to get to you in a second, but I want to piggyback off of what Ivo is saying. Can you talk to me a little bit about how you view the threat as not only something that could be accomplished by military force? What is the threat that Taiwan is facing if China decides not to invade?
Well, China has made very clear in all its instruments, documents, and speeches that, well, it is part, that Taiwan is part of the Chinese territory, and that was also part of my argument, saying that why would you want to invade a territory that is yours and that is technically recognized or legally recognized as such by a vast majority of the international community, right? We may expect a more kind of incremental interference into domestic affairs. We will see what the next elections that are coming soon in January 24 are going to bring. The Taiwanese themselves do not actually, I mean, want to really maintain the status quo. The only thing that they want to avoid is a full-fledged military conflict. And for that, of course, they need greater support of the international community. So deterring is good. Tightening ties between Japan, Europe, and the United States to make sure that China doesn't resort to the military option is absolutely crucial. But we really need to be sure to stay, to keep the fine line and to avoid a self-fulfilling prophecy in a way. There is a chance that, economic coercion is another thing. By the way, there are various ways that China uses economic coercion, and it ranges from simply achieving its strategic goals through investment, so I'm call it blackmailing, but basically using the pressure, the economic pressure to attain its goals, or punish, so or using it as a punitive measure that we could see in the case of Australia, Japan, Lithuania, and Europe. But these are slightly less, I mean, in the end, they can be overcome. The other ones are much more difficult to deal with.
Got it. In general, as we're seeing China expand investment in the region, I mean, there's been a lot of coverage about Belt and Road and some of the corruption issues that have accompanied that in various places. We've got the example of Chinese investment in Sri Lanka, which has been used to gain political leverage. But I guess as the world is deciding whether or not to take that Chinese money, how are you thinking about what strings are attached and how are you viewing alternatives?
Well, to be honest, it is a common understanding amongst many that the, you know, what is called as the debt trap is something that a lot of countries do fear and some do suffer from the BRI projects. Now, the BRI in the Middle East and North Africa is not as big as it is in other places, obviously, but it's ramping up. I think one of the major inroads for some of the sub-projects like the Health Silk Road or the HSR, which is a part of the BRI, was considered dormant, maybe even dead prior to COVID. After COVID and the dissemination of a lot of the capabilities of, you know, giving people out vaccines, the Health Silk Road was a big part in entering into the Middle East or bringing in a lot of the BRI into the Middle East through a Chinese vaccine to many Middle East and North African countries. So that is an area where, obviously, China would find inroads. But to just go back for a minute on the military side of the Chinese capability. Now, we have to understand, you know, a difference between military conflict and military effect. So China may exert military effect without military conflict. Now, exerting military effect will drain from forces in the Pacific, maneuver, logistics, repositioning, rearming, and training. And that will have effects militarily without conflict. So this idea, unless there are actually bullets being shot or bombs being lobbed, that then there is no military effect, isn't accurate. I think there could be an erosion effect over time if there is that competition, going back to that word, in a military sense, where China, builds an island in 24 hours over here, and the U.S., fleet moves a carrier group, into a certain location, that has an effect on the Pacific, the Indo-Pacific command for the U.S., for instance. And even the United States has a finite amount of capability that it could, exert capability and resources. So military effect could be something that could be exerted without military conflict. I mean, that's just as a comment on that.
Fair enough. Well, I want to ask you, Andrew, so we're looking at the threat environment, and one of the things that I think has been an anxiety about the last year has been the renewal of nuclear fears. We've seen Vladimir Putin threatening this, saber-rattling, some say. But I guess my question for you is two points. So first of all, do you think that U.S. escalation or Western escalation, or U.S. and Western concern about escalation and the fact that the threat may be moderating the Western response, is that a failure of nuclear deterrence in and of itself? And then when I'm looking at just whether we're going to live in a more nuclear world, we've got the example of Ukraine, which gave up its nukes. We've got the example of Libya. Can you talk a little bit about the incentives and what you think the implications of this are for long-term global security?
I think Putin very effectively has leveraged the residual fear of nuclear threshold being crossed. And I think that is very much on the minds of both the Biden administration and every European power. And actually, if it were not, I think we would be amiss in our duties. We need to think about this. Now, how acute is that threat is a different conversation. And I would argue that, of course, anything can happen, but at this point, the threshold is relatively low in my view. The idea that the Russians would resort to tactical nuclear weapons in the European theater would radically transform Europe, in terms of how Europe would respond, how NATO would respond, how the Chinese would respond, because that would lower the nuclear threshold in the Indo-Pacific, and that would dramatically degrade the Chinese position there, how India would respond. And the second question is, what would he use those weapons to destroy? He's already destroying cities in conventional sense. Would he kill one or two brigades? If you look at how the Ukrainians are deployed. So I think he's doing this because we are focused on it, because we are self-deterring as a result of that. If we said, for example, that we're really concerned about something totally different, I'm sure the Russians would be doing that as well, and we would stop talking about nuclear weapons. So that's the first. That's the first area. When I said that these two theaters are interconnected, what happens in Europe will dramatically impact, in my view, on what happens in Asia. Our credibility, our staying power. We have invested so much of our prestige right now into Ukraine. The Chinese are watching this very carefully, so that's the first point. The second point that we don't talk about, which is remarkable, the Russians and the Chinese have created the simultaneous two frontier crisis, right? One in Eastern Europe, the other one in the Indo-Pacific. The Ukrainians, because of their bravery, patriotism, and their really heroic struggle, they're grinding down the Russian conventional land forces on non-NATO territory. They're a non-NATO force. All they're asking for is weapons, munitions, and financial support. And in the process, they're sequencing the threat because, we can have debates to what extent, and how quickly Russia can reconstitute its forces post-war. And there are arguments in the military and analytical community on that. But the fact is that the Ukrainians are buying us time to rebuild the forces, to reconstitute our militaries, to put NATO back on its traditional collective deterrence, collective defense footing. You heard the two generals yesterday talk about what they're expecting in terms of planning to be presented in Vilnius. These plans are ready. They've been delivered. And so we are at this inflection point in history that if we actually seize this opportunity to do the right thing, then we will be fine, in my view. But what that requires is something that I find missing, for the most part, in Europe. Not on the flank. I was recently in Tallinn, and if you go to Warsaw, Helsinki, Tallinn, or Bucharest, they're razor-focused on the threat. But if you start moving across Europe, there is what I call regionalized security optics. If you're in Berlin, the conversation becomes more muted. If you go to Paris, there's a lot of interest in looking south to the Med, into Africa, and on and on. So what I'm saying is we need to rebuild a defensive mindset among our policy elites, and they need to communicate to the publics what's at stake.
That sounds to me like an opportunity. And we're here in Poland. One of the things I've been fascinated following this year is Poland buying military equipment for South Korea, which has been on active war positioned for potential defense for decades. And I guess, Professor, I wanted to ask you, Vladimir Putin is not the only insane person with a bomb. Asia seems to be pretty realistic about this. Are we paying enough attention to, first of all, North Korea? But also, with that, what opportunities is this creating for our friends in Asia to be working with Europe and with the West?
Thank you. Well, let me talk a little bit about my own perspective about the nuclear weapons or nuclear strategy. And nuclear weapon is not only for deterrence, but also for reassurance for partners and allies. That's a key message we should share. For example, the South Korean president made a visit to Washington, D.C. before G7 summit in Hiroshima, then made a historic agreement about the rotational visit of the American nuclear submarines to the South Korea. And this is the first in 40 years, and that should send a signal rightly to the North Korea, but not only limited to that. Number one is that message for South Korean people, no less need or no need for go nuclear by herself. Number two is China is a neighbor and that Russia is sharing the border with North Korea. That means not only the message for the reassurance to the South Korea only, but the message to North Korea in a the nuclear deterrence posture, but not only limited to that, the global audience and regional audience, Beijing and Moscow, that means nuclear is a very symbolic one, not only for the local fighting, but also global audience is very pretty much interested in that. In that sense, strategic communication is at play. And also, two theater may be connected in that regard.
So we're talking a lot about two theaters. General, I want to pivot a little bit to Iran. By all indications, moving faster and faster toward acquiring its own nuclear weapon. We've also seen it extending its influence in the region. At the same time, there's been an American retreat from that region. So I wanted to ask about how that's affecting regional politics in the Middle East and how that has implications beyond. I mean, we're looking at Iran providing Russia with drones to attack Ukraine. How worried are you about Iran as a destabilizing force, and is the West doing enough to balance against that?
Well, there are two facts here. Fact number one, Iran as a neighbor is not going anywhere for us. So they're there. We have to find a way to live with the fact that Iran is a neighbor. And I think that is important for, we believe it, but the world should believe also that, you know, it is in everyone's interest to not have conflict in that part of the world. A second fact, the U.S. would disagree that it's removed from that area. Now, that is something that we may debate with great power competition kind of doctrine, having a more prominent presence in Europe and in the Indo-Pacific necessitates that it would have less of a presence probably in the Middle East. Again, the U.S. would disagree with that. Now, you do see a drawdown of physical presence, obviously. That may be, in part because of Afghanistan. That may be because in part of the end of operations also in Iraq. But that is also an important element to understand when you think about, for instance, China in the Middle East, because China is becoming more prominent. You mentioned Iran. China, as I mentioned, played a major role in bringing Iran and Saudi Arabia closer, having negotiations. Obviously, it's not at the end state yet, but it's something that didn't happen before. It is a new element of Chinese influence beyond trade. Another element of Chinese influence beyond trade could be, which in the past we would have disagreed with, but now it's probable, military presence. We have projects for ports in several locations, actual or planned, in the MENA region, which is something, again, new. Good or bad is irrelevant. Does it have more influence? And the answer would be, obviously, it would, because of a more diverse presence beyond just trade. So that it's a very complex region, obviously, but very complex way of dealing with both the Russian presence or more prevalent presence in the past and the growing presence of China in the MENA region.
Eva, I want to ask you a question that shifts more to domestic politics. We're living in a much more dangerous world that requires a lot more defense spending. I think the West has been living with the assumption of a peace dividend, but we're seeing in France, pension reform has people in the streets. In the United States, even some elements of the Republican Party are worried about the clash between defense spending and entitlement spending. How do you see this playing out as countries look at their competing priorities as the world has grown more dangerous?
Well, I think it means that a lot of countries in the world are not ready to what we call decouple, or not ready really to give up their economic interest and their engagement with China. And you can see it from some of the member states' reactions, France, Germany, Italy. You can see it from Japan. I think that we will see a continuity in countries' effort to engage in China and steer and perhaps overcome some of the economic challenges and domestic challenges that they have through their engagement with China. And the whole rhetoric, and again, we are seeing this great power competition lens that is there on the American, Chinese, and everyone's lips, really, and eyes, needs to be a little bit, perhaps, adjusted. It is not by, kind of, in a way, coercing to decouple that we are going to get very far, because the realities on the ground, as you precisely said, are there. And in general terms, and I think it links up very nicely to General said on China's role in the Middle East and elsewhere, we are going to see more China, not just as an economic power, but as a player that they try to be in international politics, in the kind of new global order that they want to shape. And it's simply a fact. You know, so Middle East is one, but you've probably heard about the Global Security Initiative that China has launched. It's just one of those many initiatives that they use to reach out to the Global South, and that's why I really think that it's something that we should not underestimate, and we should really not take it lightly, because no matter how we look at it, it will backfire at some point. And it's just a new reality that we need to take into account. Yes, countries will continue probably engaging and cooperating with China. We just need to set the rules. And we will see more China. And just to finish on that, what you asked about the Polish-Korea and the kind of increasing links between Europe and Asia, I think this is an extremely important one. Because if we look at this two-front theater predicament from a triangular perspective, the one leg that really needs to be reinforced is the Europe-Asia relations. So the Polish-Korean industrial cooperation, but also Japan. There's a deal with Japan, Italy, and the UK on the new fighter jets. This is the leg of this triangle that needs to be reinforced.
Great. Andrew, I think you had a point you wanted to raise.
I just wanted to address what Eva said, and I am not as certain. When you say, that Europe will remain engaged in China to the same extent and the rest of it, because, and you may be right, I'm simply saying I don't know. But what I would argue is that how Europe rolls on China will be critical to transatlantic relations. This is our number one adversary, and the Europeans, I think, are keenly aware of this. The whole idea of de-risking is seeking a compromise that would be acceptable on both sides of the Atlantic, that is to find a formula to stay in the Chinese market and at the same time not to antagonize the United States on some key areas. I am very skeptical that this will actually be successful. It's a bit like trying to be half pregnant. We're going to do risk, but we're going to do that. I think at some point we will have to ask the question why our key allies are feeding technology and money to China. And this is a problem for the US as well. This is not, I'm not pointing fingers. China is embedded so deeply in Western economies after four decades of this, when we granted a 1.4 billion communist state unfettered access to every level of our society. We took jewels in the crown of our technology and we handed it over to them. Remember during the Cold War, we had COCOM restrictions in NATO. You couldn't sell an Intel 386 PC to the Russians because it was considered dual use. So the insanity of what happened over the last 40 years, and I've been writing for over two decades, ranting like a Jehovah, that this is self-defeating. We're creating what Nixon called a Frankenstein. Shortly before his death, I believe he said that. And yet we decouple the national security function of the state, which is the irreducible function, from economic policy, and we allowed greed masquerading as an ideology, that China will become more prosperous, then it will become more pluralistic, and I think it was Bob Zelig who said it will become a responsible stakeholder in the international system. This was nonsense from the start. So, as my relatives in Tennessee say, if you find yourself in a hole, stop digging. So, I don't know if the Chinese can innovate without access to our R&D, but stop training their weapons designers in our universities. Stop relying on them for our medications. Reshore, friendly shore, whatever the hell you want to do with this, but stop. The argument that because they're so deeply embedded in our systems and there's interdependence and the rest of it, wars have happened when countries were interdependent in the past. So this is not an excuse for not doing what's right.
Got it. I'm going to open it up to questions in just a moment. I've got one last question here, but we're going to do very short questions and very short answers, if you don't mind. So keep it under 30 seconds, and let's keep the response under a minute. But Professor, I wanted to ask you, we're talking about the China threat, and China clearly has aspirations to become the predominant world power. In what ways should we be paying attention to more how it is seeking to change the world order or set norms around its preferences? Are there areas that we haven't brought up that are really big deals because they affect how we live our lives and the extent to which we exercise freedom in the West?
Very tough question. Well, I used to be a very good supporter of the liberal international order. But now it's facing a big, big challenge. Number one is, as you mentioned, China. China set the agenda and the kind of alternative models, or alternative world visions, or alternative organizations. And they are very good at institutional buildings, following the Belt and Road Initiative. That means not only speaking only about the idea and providing money, but having an organization, institution, and followers, and also a process of moving ahead and having their own concept of order. And that's a big, big challenge. Now, the Taiwan contingency is a hot agenda. That is a kind of litmus test, how serious Chinese leadership is into a liberal order or international order, not only according to their own agenda, but to open up and share their agenda with us. We will see.
Great. With that, we're going to take some questions. Let's give it to the gentleman right there. Yes.
Paul Schultz from London, and this is mostly to Professor Yoshizaki. It's about nuclear. You spoke about the stabilizing and assurance role of nuclear weapons. Well, agreed, but how does that square with the traditional Japanese ambivalence about this and bringing out Hiroshima bomb survivors at the Hiroshima event, and generally wanting to downplay and deplore the role of nuclear weapons in the world? How explain that schizophrenia? And secondly, related, the role of British...
we're just going to do one question.
Nuclear weapons, where do they fit in your vision?
Okay, very short answer. Well, I had an interview with the Asahi newspaper, known to be a very liberal one, and also an article describing the comparison of the Hiroshima's opinion about nuclear weapons and Japanese nationwide opinions. And we found out there's no big gap in between. That means Hiroshima's people, even in the citizens in Hiroshima, are so accustomed to the nuclear reality, like North Korea and China and Russia. In that sense, that is a positive sign that they are much more ready to think into the idea of living with nuclear weapons. Well, nuclear weapons was a taboo, but now nuclear reality is a challenging one. In that sense, it's a big change.
Great. Gentleman in the front row.
Thanks very much indeed. Benjamin Tallis, German Council on Foreign Relations. Eva Pejsova, you mentioned European attitudes, and for me this was a classic example of European fatalism about attitudes that we need to accept as a reality rather than trying to shape that reality. That depends, I think, on two things: how we live up to the values we claim to embody, and the kind of order that we're able to shape on the world stage. And I want to hear from the panel about how we can do those things in order to deal with this linkage between theaters and the systemic competition. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I understand that there's the next session is entirely devoted to that, but I agree with you. I'm not saying it's a good thing to do. I'm just saying that as we observe, and the ironies we see over the last couple of years from, you know, very powerful speeches, that, you know, almost hawkish tones in Brussels that are, you know, unprecedented. And you know, it's really a continuation of a trend that started many years ago, started from 5G, etc. You see this gradual kind of upscaling, and then you know, it's not triggering the alarms about strategic investments, but then the German Chancellor allows the purchase of a major port. And we've had so many examples in the past. We have had the port of Piraeus. We have had so many other ports. I mean, there's a zillion examples you can cite of how we demonstrated the real danger of opening up, of not being careful, and yet we keep doing it. And it's, you know, so I agree in that sense with Andrew. That the whole de-risking rhetoric is not making much sense because we keep talking about de-risking and then selling Airbus helicopters to China. So it's not, I mean, these are things that are so dual use, you could hardly think of more. So it's not even a fine line, and I don't even see the effort there. It's a difficult question. So, of course, strengthening the transatlantic alliance is a hugely important thing. Building up militarily, helping and making sure that we try to do our best to deal with Ukraine to enable the U.S. to fully rebalance to China. Also through working with our Asian partners, and that is ongoing as well. It's not just those defense deals, but it's in many ways. On the anti-coercion as well. And by the way, I mean, if we talked about G7 and the kind of effort to coordinate, the EU's anti-coercion instrument could be a possible inspiration for that. I mean, it's as close as we get to some sort of coordinated instrument to that. But again, I mean, as with many things in Europe, you end up with extremely slow procedures, consensus-based negotiation, and in the end, it's always the member states that have that decide. So, no clear answer.
All right, let's take the gentleman in the aisle there.
Ray Wojcik from the Kosciuszko chain in Warsaw. Great panel, thank you very much. I wonder, one of the counters to China investment in the region is specifically is the Three Seas Initiative. And the Three Seas Initiative needs a lot more investment, and it could be a lot more investment from Western European partners. How can we encourage that as a way to compete, at least, on a level playing field with China investment in the region and the port problem you just mentioned?
Andrew, do you want to take that?
Ray, I couldn't agree more. I think this is critical, not just in terms of economic development. It's also infrastructure investment. You know, most of the European infrastructure, you know, rail, roads, et cetera, are still to some extent post-imperial, running east-west. We need to build north-south connectivity. It's critical to military mobility and to defending the flank. I think we'll boil down to leadership. You know, very clear encouragement and messaging from respective governments. And also sorting out some of the vested interests within the European Union, because large infrastructure projects are always seen in the competitive context, you know, how it's going to impact the rest of it. We should really prioritize this, and I think this would create also a very important incentive to what lies on the other side of the border. You know, a successful Ukraine would have a transformative impact on Belarus. I mean, you're talking about a regional change that we haven't seen for years. So I am all for it. I'm concerned that we kind of slowed down a bit at our end in terms of encouraging investment. So I think it'll boil down to leadership. And I think this is one of the most significant projects that should be focused on, and it should be advertised and promoted at every opportunity that we have.
All right, time for one more question. Let's take that gentleman.
Konstantin Eggert from Deutsche Welle. My question is actually to General Nawaf. I'm interested in the Middle East. I've spent quite some time there. In the context of our discussion, after the deal between Iran and Saudi Arabia and the general normalization following the Abraham Accords and no more peace for Israel, do you think the U.S. influence in the region is essentially mortally wounded? And if so, can the US do something about it? And in this respect, what is the big Chinese plan for the region, if there is any? Shukran jazilan.
Afwan. Well, I'll get to your second question about China and the region in a second, but I would disagree that the U.S.'s influence is mortally injured, because I would disagree with those first two points, that there is an agreement between Saudi Arabia and Iran. There is a rapprochement, there are discussions, they're closer diplomatically, the ties are back, but we should wait and see. We're encouraging, obviously, peace in the region, but that is not the same as having a deal, because it's not specifically dealing with a certain subject. I will also disagree on the second point with the Abraham Accords. Unless you know something I don't, I didn't notice peace in the Middle East yet.
Great.
So you probably could inform me about that.
We've got about 30 seconds.
So that is important to understand. Now, China, in 30 seconds, is difficult to answer, but it's something to be aware of, that it goes beyond economy. China is expanding in influence in new ways that it hasn't in the past. And however you view that, it's very interesting, and we should discuss more about that. But in 15 seconds, I don't think we can.
Well, I'm pressing, because there's a really cool video that I think wraps up a lot of this. So we're going to play it now. On that note, we live in a more dangerous world, but we've got great ideas about it. Thank you very much.